It is not for youth, it's actually for everybody. So I encourage you please to write as much as you can write. The Lagos Business School will give you the information I'm about to give you. But they will put it in 6 months modules and charge you 2 million. So you're getting it for free, and I want to please give it all your attention. Your life will be the same after this lecture. If you are alive on December 31st, 1999, please raise your hand. December 31st, 1999. If you are not alive, don't bother to raise your hand. I assume we're all alive, really? Okay, that was the end of what? The 20th century. It was the 20th century. You must answer me back. Say 20th century. That was the end of the 20th century. If you are alive on January 1st, 2000, please raise your hand. January 1st, year 2000, if you are alive. Very good. That was the beginning of what? The 21st century. Now, when a generation is alive today to see the end of one century and to wake up the next morning to experience the beginning of another century, that's a very special generation. So I'm going to say I'm special.
Special.
Say I'm special.
I'm special.
You're special because you witnessed the end of one century and you saw the next morning the beginning of another. Many are born after a century has started and they die before the century. It's true of us. On December 31st, 2099, if you are going to be alive, praise the Lord. December 31st, 2099. That's 83 years from now.
I'm going to be alive.
There will be two sellers in this room.
I'm going to be alive.
Very, very excited to you. None of us would likely be around by the end of the 21st century. So it simply means that even though we saw the end of the 20th, and we're alive to see the beginning of the 21st, we will not see the, we may not, most likely not see the end of the 21st, and surely we'll not see the beginning of the 22nd. So it means that our purpose, our achievements will be done in this century and will die in this century. So we are then called the children of the 21st century. Everyone say, I am a child of the 21st century. Let's say it again, I'm a child of the 21st century. Now, if you prosper and die in a century, it then becomes imperative to understand the characteristic of that century. You just want to go through it one step forward, two step backward. You must understand its peculiarities, its challenges, and dimension them properly against your own aspiration. So if you don't know it, you are not likely to make success. So the purpose of this lecture is to tell us what exactly is the 21st century. What are its characteristics? What are its challenges? How do we leverage it? How do we mitigate the challenges and leverage the opportunities? Because without understanding it, all our effort and exertion will fall over. So to start with, it's important to understand that the last 10 years of any century, the last 10, 20 years of any century, the speed of change becomes supersonic. Everybody says supersonic.
Super.
You remember when we used to use cassette tapes and we rewind? What happens to us then? When you rewind the cassette tape?
It's faster.
The speed increases. That's why everyone says supersonic speed. That's what happens. Isn't it? Exactly the same thing happened when a century is about to end. In the last 10, 20 years of a century, changes will just happen like that. In life, in economics, in technology, and those changes give us a glimpse of the character of the coming century. The reason that though we live in the darkest part of the planet, I was in a program at the ESA in Barcelona 2012, and somebody from Harvard showed us the map of the world at night, taken from space. The darkest part is around where we are, Africa, and you can see light. So the lighter your section, the more industrialized and the more life is better. So because we function from the darkest part of the planet, where ignorance leads knowledge. Our leaders are not even aware of the changes that are taking place, not to talk of mitigating against those changes. So this lecture is about those changes and how they impact you and I and our society. So whether you're a policymaker, you're a business person, you're a teacher, you must have clarity on the reality of the century so that your personal aspirations and the policies you're making can be in tune with those realities. So let's look at the last 20 years of the 21st or the 20th century. Between 1984 and the year 2000, three things happened that affected economy, technology, and politics. The introduction of the internet, the fall of the Berlin Wall, and the release of Nelson Mandela, coming back. Three things that happened between 1984 and 2000 that is driving the reality of our life globally, in Africa, in Nigeria, in the 21st century. And without a clear understanding of how these things impact our lives, we're not likely going to make success in the 21st century. Let's start with the internet. In 1984, the World Wide Web was created, true or false? Around it, okay? And that World Wide Web is what? Information communication technology, true or false? I need you to answer. I'm not getting paid for this. So if I need my time to come and share with you, the least you can do is to respond to my prompting. True or false? Information communication technology led to a flat world where the speed of information disruptions. Yes, the world is not all the same. The most important critical part is the rise of the robots. Everybody say the rise of the robots.
The rise of the robots.
The robots start from. Can you move up your mobile phones? Can you show me? Yes, many of you don't go to bed. You can't even put it off. And that in this century, robots will have women as pets. Don't go to me. It was the MD of Apple that made that statement at a conference in California in 2015. And we said he's a madman. That in this century, robots will lead man. He's already leading. Your phones, your computers, everything. And particularly, the job of 20 people will be done by one computer. So joblessness will be a critical feature of the 21st century. So those of you that are looking for jobs, you start looking for jobs. Because in the 21st century, there will be no more jobs, only customers. Everybody say, jobs.
Jobs.
Customers.
Customers.
Not jobs.
Not jobs.
Yeah, repeat again.
Customers.
One more time.
Customers.
One more time.
Customers.
One more time. Customers. In the 21st century, even if you have a job, if you cannot generate and sustain customers, you will lose it. So why look for jobs? Because in reality, once you have customers, you are prosperous. So even in our education system, the moment we change our curriculum to entrepreneurship as the core of teaching, vocational training, you have empowered people to generate customers. Job creators rather than job seekers. And like I said, ignorance leads knowledge in Nigeria. And until we are ready to change that, then we're all going to be in trouble. In societies where knowledge drives society, in South Korea, for example, when I used to consult for Education Trust Fund, we went to different countries in the world and told them, let's go and see what countries are doing with technical vocational education. We got to South Korea, 70% the education budget is in vocational and technical education. The oil industry in Nigeria spends over $1 billion or $2 billion every year to bring underwater welders from Malaysia and Indonesia. There are no Nigerians that can do welding under the weather, and we have another industry. So, in that, between 1984, the internet came and changed the world. But the impact is that computers have taken over the jobs in Japan. The receptionist in this hotel will be a robot in Japan. A robot. Toyota says there are factories where robots work for 30 days producing cars without any human being. 5 days ago, I was watching a documentary in the house on China television. A port in China, bigger times 10 of our port, had no human being. The port is automated. machines removing containers and transporting them. And you know where the controls were? On the ground. Even the road to Apapa was not prepared. And you say you have a nation. So the reality of our life is that in this century, there will be no jobs, only customers, and robots to rule us. That is just one thing that happened in the last 20 years of the 21st century that's given us a glimpse of the character of the 21st century. That I'm sure our policymakers don't even know. Maybe we need to bring the president and all the ministers and send them in the room and tell them. Probably not aware. And that is why education is still creating federal universities with budget for studies in languages, and all, which is not wrong. However, 70% should be towards what? Technology. Another thing that happened in that time was the fall of the Berlin Wall. For the purpose of our time, you know, but just to say that the day the Berlin Wall fell, our economy began regression. Because either the world was divided by the Iron Curtain into East and West. We lined up the West, and some lined up the East. But the day Reagan and Gorbachev shook hands and said, look, the Cold War is over, the war fell, and those benefits that we're getting as vassal supporters of the West died. Suddenly, electricity was no longer existing. The technology was taken away. I grew up in Lagos. Even if you don't have water in your house, you have on the streets. There's no more water. All the taps are dry. In those days, many years ago, when NEPA takes like the host to shout, NEPA! And within 2 minutes, NEPA will bring water. Today, there's even no NEPA. Because the technology was taken. I grew up on a university campus where people would take ₦5 and eat chicken and rice and tea on Sunday afternoon. Where are the cafeterias? The Yakubu Gowon Library, Unilag, was one of the best in Africa. What's happened to it today? Our teaching hospitals, what it did. I mean, everything you can mention in this country has gone off. Because the Berlin Wall fell. Is it Nelson Mandela's release that Nigeria midwifed? And today, to take a South African visa, you deposit $1,000. And they will use to deport you to spend 1 month in the visa. The same country. And Obasanjo was the chairman of the eminent persons group that negotiated the release of Nelson Mandela. Thabo Mbeki lived in Surulere as a rep of ONC. He unilagged many universities. Many of them were trained free by Nigeria. But the moment Mandela became president, as Africa became independent, the world shifted its attention from Nigeria to where? To South Africa. They moved the headquarters of their businesses, and today, for the next 20 years, foreign direct investment coming this side will pass through where?
South Africa.
So if you're in business and looking for partnership, you better look at South Africa. There are new colonial masters, they're already here, but they're neo-colonialists, they're economic colonialists, from DSTV, to MTN, to Protea, to Southern Sun, to ShopRite, it's new colonial. That's life. They're not married, you better look for yourself. I mean, this. So I will help you. We can be talk by Papa. Women love Nigerian men anyway, so it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Just to show you things that happened innocently within this period that gave us a glimpse of our reality. That, like I said, where ignorance leads knowledge. Those realities will not be mitigated. We won't do things to ensure. I mean, if Nigerian, if we had leaders who knew, we'll have negotiated a better deal with South Africa. They will be paid off reparation for the next 30 years. So now we have clarity of why the 21st century appears to be the way it is. Where there's no, there are no jobs, our economy is regressing, our infrastructure is dying, things are just going bad. They'll begin to wonder why. So we have an understanding. And there's a positive side to the changes that occur when the century is ending and when it's starting. There is always an unction that the Holy Spirit is available to those who can dream beyond their circumstances. Obama is an example. Because that's a classic case of uncommon faith begetting uncommon faith. I mean, that guy is not possible. It's not possible. Numbers. For a black man to have said, I want to run for presidency and become president, it's difficult. But because it happened at the beginning of the new century. A common example was the Wright brothers. A brotherhood that wanted to do the first aeroplane. They were struggling towards the end of the 19th century. that at the break of the 20th century, 1901, they succeeded in flying the first aeroplane. Before they succeeded, they were moving from one city to the other because the religious of those moment wanted to crucify them for daring God. Because they believe only God can create something to fly. But as the 20th century broke, in 1901, at their normal 30th attempt, the plane took off. So I'm saying that things can happen also supernaturally within the first few years of a new century for those who are able to tear beyond their circumstances. And that means in the 21st century, courage will be a very important element of success. It's not going to be for those who are afraid or who want all the answers before they take a leap. And that will lead me to the definition of the 21st century. There are two definitions. The first, that it is an age of all reason. Everyone say age? Nobody is asking you your
age.
Of what?
Of all reason.
Yeah, repeat after me.
Age of all reason.
One more time.
Age of all reason.
Yeah, keep on saying that.
Age of all reason.
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 Thank you very much. If you know you are reasonable in this room, raise your hand. Only reasonable. I don't want to understand what you mean. Okay, how many people are reasonable? Are you unreasonable? You are reasonable. Please raise up your hand, reasonable. Okay. Tunde, are you reasonable or unreasonable? I know you're very reasonable. Thank you very much. If you know you're unreasonable, raise up your hand. Raise the way, you're not sure. Raise the top way. Are you unreasonable? These two gentlemen are reasonable. Okay, now in the 21st century, the definition of a reasonable person is somebody that tries to adapt himself to the world. A follow-follow. Everybody say follow-follow.
Follow-follow.
A reasonable person in this century is a follow-follow. But an unreasonable person is a person that strives for the world to adapt to him or her, pioneer. Those who dare where angels do not even tread. Those who have to wait for all the answers to take a step. They are liar bankers. Those have been predicted to be those who own and prosper in the 21st century. So in the 21st century, the unreasonable man and woman will prosper. And who's an unreasonable man? I talk in the political space, and Obama will be an unreasonable man. True of us?
Yes.
Yeah, it's very unreasonable. He wrote the book, The Audacity of Hope, to confirm his unreasonableness. I am Banda in Bambo. So except you have courage in this century, because if you look at the set from the beginning, crisis, Al-Qaeda, Boko Haram, ISIS, it's crisis upon what?
Crisis.
So to try in the century like that, it was our courage. If you come down a bit, if you try to get people out, you can. David will be an example of an unreasonable person who went to the camp of Saul and was meant to give snacks to his brothers and decided that he was going to kill Goliath. And everyone said, okay, come, let's even sacrifice this one to Goliath tonight so he can let us rest. And they gave him spear and what? Oh. And hammer. And Goliath saw him and said, oh, this people, how can you be so stupid? This dog, you want to send to me? And he said, well, you come to me with spear, I come to you what? He revealed the name of God and something happened. The pastors will tell you that I'm praying for that. God lent David. Everybody say, God, lend David his eyes. The moment he invoked God. That's also the God factor. Because I can't stand here and tell you that there's a solution to anything without God factor. Except there's God factor and there's no good sources. And David's example confirms the truth. Because the Bible said he removed that garment and threw down the spear. And what did he go and look for?
Stones.
How do you kill a man of about 30 feet high, clad in metals, It's a small space there, and he said, I want to kill you with a stone. He must have seen something. Something must have been revealed to him. And the revelation to my mind was that God showed him that Jehoiada was just a giant of clay. That was a giant of clay.
Giant of clay.
I'm and the father of all clays, no matter how big, is what? The stone. Just get the stone with one critical angle to break. And that was what David did. And David could not have done that without insight, without a revelation by God. And the rest is history. Two of us. He killed Goliath, he became king. Even the city of God is called the city of God. He got away with money. And so in this century too, it's important for us to ask for God's eyes to see the end from the beginning. Because honestly, there is no formula, there is no solution. You can say our country. As we are getting richer, we are getting poorer. There is just no other way except that insight is also available. And I'm speaking about an age of unreason. Because it would have been unreasonable of David, ideally, to go and look for a stone to kill him. There are probably Goliath in our life today that we are thinking we can destroy. Could be financial, could be anything. Remember, they are just giants of clay. Say it now. May I repeat the game?
Giants of clay.
The mere stone, with the force of a strong catapult, if it hits the right place, that giant of what?
Go down, go.
So, in the 21st century, we have to even be unreasonable with our faith. That's the point of it. Uncommon faith begets uncommon favor. So you can't say you want to do a business and you are not courageous to take the bold step. You are looking for all the money before you start. It's not going to happen in this century. Once you have the clarity and knowledge and you are convinced and you are put it before God, take the step of faith. Take what? Take the step of and move forward. And that is why if anybody comes up today and says he's going to challenge the president and run for the president, I will support him. Yes. We need people to come out and say, stop, it must stop, this nonsense must stop. Leave a man in 79 and he's sick, and he's sitting in second time, and we're all sitting down, and we're all looking. We are going to be dead. That's the truth. If Obama did not step out at that time, would he have become president? Yes, he stood up. He had no money. He had no pedigree. He was a black man, an aberration, a reaction to which even the whites have reacted to by bringing in another Trump with all his circumstances. It is in reaction to the Obama emergence that I would rather take this man rather than anybody else to consider. The Clintons, the mistake the Clintons was that they allowed the Obamas to passionately canvas for them? Because as far as the whites were concerned, this is another woman in black skin, in white skin, another woman. They didn't want it to happen. So we need courage, even to change our political circumstances. We need courage to change our financial circumstances. We need courage to survive and prosper in the 21st century. We need to become unreasonable. The second definition is that it's an age of paradox. Everybody say paradox. The paradox is when right becomes wrong and wrong becomes right. Abi? In our country, wrong is becoming right. A man stole money, the government accused him, indicted him, he ran out of the country, another government brings him in quietly. And washes his garment. And when we shouted, we also helped him out of town. This aberration will not go on forever. But it shows this country is in a state of paradox. But the paradox I want to talk about today is economic paradox. By 2000, at the break of the new century, the prediction was that half the number of people working will be part-time workers. Half that will have full-time jobs will be known as knowledge workers. Those who can rain water to stone. Those that will get to an organization that is dying and they will revive it. The knowledge workers. Everybody say knowledge workers.
Knowledge workers.
They will represent only 50% of the workforce. while the other 50 will be running on. The part-time workers, all the people you see in the banking hall are part-time workers. Only few people are full-time workers in that bank. The part-time workers are also graduates who are probably struggling. They earn nothing, because what they earn is not enough to sustain them for the month. As long as by the time they collect their salary, they pay off the debts accumulated over the month. By the next month, the same item they bought last month, inflation will have increased. So their salary, being the same, will pay and they still have debts. So technically, they are earning nothing. But meanwhile, up here, these times two, these knowledge workers will determine what they want to earn. It's happening in the banking industry, in the oil and gas industry, the technological industry, in a bit of advertising industry. Where people now, because of their creativity, can say, this is what I want to earn, and they're giving. A friend of mine left a major telecom company a couple of years ago at CMO. His exit package was over 250 million. And while I was there, I was there about 100 million. And he had a budget of 8 billion every year. Those pouring water from what? From stone. But ironically, those who earn a lot of money will have to lose three times their current output. It means that they have no rest. They are working all the time. They arrive in New York today, tomorrow they're leaving for New York. Paradoxically, those who have no money will have all the time in the world to cause havoc. Because they're idle. So you have the kidnappers, you have the armed robbers, you have cultism in school, you have Yahoo, you have all kinds of area boys. They are here, they have nothing to lose, they have no money, and they have all the time in the world. Those who have the money won't have time to enjoy it. Because these guys, you're giving these guys stress, and that's his paradox. That is another picture of the 21st century. Are we not witnessing it?
Yeah.
It's a reality. A common friend of ours was going to Kogi from Abeokuta a couple of months ago, Dr. Adeyeju, and he was there at Kore. He had armed robbers were robbing in front, just trying to get out of his car to run and hide. He car hit him and died. The potential president of Nigeria. Nobody was blamed. I mean?
Yes.
How many kidnap stories have you had that if they captured those who kidnapped? Because the police are probably in cohorts with the kidnappers. Yes. So we're in trouble. So even if you're earning money here, you're not at peace. Because these guys are there to show you that money is their own. So, while it's an age of opportunities for the reasonable man, it's also an age of
paradox.
Everybody say age of paradox. And that is the century in which we're going to live and die. And without this understanding, we'll just continue to eat our mala and we'll do and think life. Better solutions. Because my message this morning is not to just paint a picture of despondency, it also shows some light into how we can mitigate. That is the benefit of those of you that are here this morning. I don't have paper to give, and I don't give papers. It's only those that hear it, that hear it. I mean?
Yeah.
Those who don't come, they don't hear it. As simple as that. So what are the solutions? I'm going to give three solutions. Maybe attractive, yes. Two is, one is individual solution, the other is corporate, for those of you in business. And then the third one is an advice to government, for those who are in government, for those who have the years of government, people like Tony can talk to them, people in power. The first is the individual solution. How many people have eaten the donut in Mr. Beats before? Those of you. Don't know to Mr. Beast. Okay, very, very nice. Don't tell me. That That donut is a glorified puff puff.
Yes.
My mother was a caterer, and since age 11, I've been rolling pastries. So I know all the formula for donuts at the back. Hopefully one day, I'll set up my first food and come to donate. But the donut I grew up to know was a round bunch of flour with a hole at the center. True or false? That's donut. Now, but listen very carefully. At the individual level, we are told that our total, the totality of our opportunities is in the donut. But the small hole at the center represents our area of core competence. That was a core competence. That is your area of certification. When you train, when you have a degree. And like I said, in the 21st century, none of us will be able to survive from income from our core area of competence. A new principal of school, my school, seventh grade school, Yoruba Adelaja, built a school for his wife, sent his children abroad, bought houses in Peter's and Lukwetu on the salary of a principal. I'm sure some principals cannot even pay the school fees of their school in which they are principal, because their salary is not enough. So, we're enjoined to look at the bigger space within the donuts for additional sources of income. In the 21st century, in the 20th, we used to talk about core competence. Just focus on what we're doing. Don't get distracted. Just focus, it's a lie. In the 21st century, if you do not have multiple competences, you are dead. And the reason is simple. Change in tastes, competition, and change in government policy are factors in the environment that are beyond your control. So one single policy of government can erode your competitive advantage. And that's where you sit and say you're making money and you're gathering. You just find out that you're nothing happening there. Because of competition, what's the competition?
Competition.
Change in taste.
Change in taste.
Change in government policy.
Change in government policy.
Competition.
Competition.
Change in taste.
Change in taste.
Change in government policy.
Change in government policy.
Those are factors that are beyond your control. And therefore, if you're wise to sit down on your core competence and the income diary and say, I am happy and satisfied. So within the donut, there are a couple of talents, but for the purpose of this, let's deal with two. That was a pedigree talent.
Pedigree talent.
And natural talents.
And natural talents.
A pedigree talent is the talent that is transferred from our parents to us. I just told you of mine. The son of a caterer, who still has the formula for the best meat pie in the world.
Wow.
Yes, my mother's meat pie, we had to deal with a bottle of Coke. That was lunch. I stepped before, and I won't die with it. That is very important. So it means that if everything fails, I can activate my, I can do it. And don't be surprised, one day you will know that, this is this man's impact. What is your very important? What did you learn from your parents? Where have you hidden it? Because of your education and certification. Let me tell you, certificate, university degree in the 21st century is a bajumon certificate. It's a certificate to say you are an enlightened member of society. Very few people, except those in first class, will succeed in life through the income from their certificate. That's the truth in the 21st century. It's going to be very useless. What will be important is what you know, what you can do. Pedigree talent. The other is natural talent. The gift that God has given to you. Now you probably know it exists, but you're not turning it into an economic center. You're not generating income from it. You're just agreeing with it. Okay, it's just that. Let me tell you, my 15 years ago, I discovered I could be a motivational speaker. Today, I charge $1 million for this lecture. And if you don't pay me, I'm doing sure. And those that pay me even give me extra when I finish. I'm writing the book. I'm sure that when I finish it, you'll buy it as well. True of us.
True.
And so, I'm already eating from my natural talent. What is your own natural talent? What are you doing with this? Are you burying it? Eh? Somebody this year is a story. But what is yours? It is in this 21st century, multiple competency is the word. You need to activate your natural or pedigree talent and add it to your core to have peace of mind. Because if you are challenged with your core area of income, anxiety can cause high blood pressure. High blood pressure can lead to kidney failure, and that is terminal death. Because you have another source. All of a sudden, that source that you always need just close fast. When the bank consolidation first came, almost 700,000 jobs and 3 million indirect jobs were lost. Some people died. Because they never imagined life. They were used to just collecting a salary from the bank, collecting loan, allowances, and all of a sudden, no more. And that's where you know your true friends, because they have no friends. So I enjoy in the 21st century. You need to migrate from core competence to what?
Natural.
Multiple competence. Say it again. Core competence is for the 20th century. 21st century is about what?
Multiple competences.
And when you have multiple competences, you have multiple streams of income. It is only through multiple competences that you have multiple streams of income. So at any point in time, at least all the two or three sources will not drop at the same time. True of it. Your gift, your dignity will continue to be maintained. There will be no anxiety that will make a compromise with integrity. I'm going to vote for the president, not to vote for the cost of 5,000. You stand firm, isn't it?
Yes.
So the 21st century, the dual principle encourages to add to your core a natural talent or a pedigree talent. So you can move from core to multiple competency and have multiple streams. I don't want to go religious, but look at Genesis 2, there's a part that talks about four streams living in the Garden of Eden. Kishon, Ephraim, and then the last two. And underneath all these streams was wealth of the world, oil and gas, diamonds. So even the good Lord, even at the fall of the garden, wanted us to have streams of the garden. Streams of what?
Income.
Multiple streams of what?
Income.
They say, I'm working 9 to 5. How about your weekend? What are you doing with it? It's only in Nigeria that people go to work night and say, I'm back from work. Go to England and America. Our brothers have three jobs. I have a brother in India for the last 30 years. He still does three jobs. He's a government official. When he leaves, he still has an hotel where he supervises the kitchen. It's an illusion of the person to assume that you will succeed and live with just your income. And say you are broke, pray to God, go to camp. That's not the solution. God is not going to answer that prayer. As long as everybody will be sat down and write it down. This is very important. Diligence, we are repeat after me.
Diligence
is the mother of good luck.
Diligence
is the mother of good luck.
Have
you written that? Let me go to number one. God gives all things to industry. Let me repeat.
God gives all things.
Repeat again. Diligence is the mother of good luck. God gives all things to industry. Work while it is called today. Did I say it?
Work while it is called today.
Work while it is called today.
Work while it is called today.
For you do not know the hindrance tomorrow will bring. There is nothing like good luck. It's diligence. The Bible says, say that a man that diligence is worse than what? He will die with kings and princes. Diligence. And nature, God, will give everything to industry, hard work. So when you have a job of 95 and you're talking about prosperity, where do you want to get it? They say you want to steal. Yeah. What are you doing with ambition? What are you doing with the free time, the public holidays? Where are you? The 21st century is about multiple competences. And you can't have multiple competences without hard work. I mean, it's difficult to juggle and not talk of two, three things at the same time to bring them to success consistently. Because hard work. Focus. So when multiple streams of income come, that is a big man. It's not good luck, it's diligence. And God did not give it to you because you are lazy, he gave it because you are what? Industrious. Okay. So for the corporate bodies, if you are an entrepreneur in this room, can you please raise up your hand? You're working for yourself. You're not an employee. Raise up your hand. Are you sure? Okay. Very good, very good. This one is for you. It is called the Principles of the Second Call. I told you, Lagos Business School will charge you 1 million naira for this course. About 6 months. The principle of what? The principles of the second call. This is letter S. And like you can see, whatever goes on was what? Was what? You're not talking.
Calm down.
It's calm down. Whatever goes on. The law of diminishing returns. No matter how beautiful an idea is. Whatever is at some stage, it's going to be challenged. How many people have drank one with a year? I assume everybody has drank it. When I was young, it was a drink used to take to writing. People were recuperating in the hospital, they never did it. And when competition came, they did a research and found that in the household, the father, the mother, and the children, the mother determines when and what and when to wear, when and what to buy. I mean, yeah. That as women I want to do, daddy, I'm available with them. They won't spend their money. They must blackmail you to buy for the children. So the father buys, isn't it? Yeah. The who consumes? So when that result came, and they were having challenges with moving stock out because of competition, they decide to spend a couple of millions and change the focus of the same thing from recuperating aunties and adults to children. And then they said it is the vitamin A to Z of children. And they spent a lot of money to make a lot of money. Did we believe it or not? We believed it. And was I buying for our children? And then when the conversation began to come, parents thought, look, I can't grow and I can't be better for these children than this boy for them. Because they still have to buy sugar and milk. So because come and don't worry, we will begin to mix milk and sugar. So that stemmed the problem initially. But recently, they did a research again and look, there's too much confusion in the market. There's Ovaltine, there's Milo, there's Ponto, there's all kinds of concussions. So the researcher came back and said, look, from what we have seen in this family, there's a woman that has money now, not the father. Many times the father is the one that tells the mother, mommy, I'm even more richer. How come the women are more and richer than men? So if you take an example of their hair, the attachment they buy. I'm sure that's an attachment and see that cost $150,000. How much do you cut your hair, sir?
500.
So the fathers are poorer now. And the mother, because they take our own money to their food. That's why they can afford the one attachment. And that money, different stats.
Yeah.
And so they came back to Bombita. And in their 50th anniversary, 23 years ago, they said, it looks as if we must focus this dream to you. Then it was happening. So what did they do? They gave calls to the Bombita. Did you notice?
Yes.
They did calls.
Yes.
They did the shape of the lunar figure eight. Yes. And they added feminine colors of purple and pink. Mm. What are they doing? There was a reinvention.
Reinvention.
Say it again.
Reinvention.
Say it again.
Reinvention.
The same product, the same formula, have moved from hospital regulators document drink to vitamin for children, and within the space of 30, 40 years, very soon you will see a beautiful woman in the packet of Bovita and say, this is the drink that makes men's skin shine. And I can assure you, it's going to sell like Wi-Fi. Because women, anything that makes their skin shine, they will buy, they will die there. They will take in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening. In between. And that is invention. And so is business in this century. There must be constant reinvention. So let's take the first S, for example, as your first business. Those of you in business, assuming you're your first business. And the first rise of that S, they tell us that it is our peak. Everybody say peak. That is, that business has gotten to where it is getting to. And usually the peak period is 5 to 10 years. When your business is so good that you can turn down customers, and we're very busy, our hands are full, I'm engaged in the center. Let me just tell you somebody else, my colleague, that can take your order. How many people are in that position? Yes. If you're in business in the last 5 to 10 years, it is likely that you have reached your peak, the moment where your customers are guaranteed. I mean, you don't have to worry. I mean, I've been in business next year, my 30th anniversary of myself. And I have clients who call me every year. You have to call me. I say, okay, now, let's chat. The empty, you have not. Yeah, so what are the new ideas now? You spent 100 million last time. You spent 200 million every year. No, okay. This is the trend. This is what, so we end up with 150. So I am part of their budget because of the fact that the business has reached once. You have confidence. The client has confidence in past solutions that even have worked. I mean, and the trust that you have trend. You know what's going on. I mean, so you can guide them in the right direction. So when a business is at its peak, the usual refrain of a typical African is to take the second one, or to buy that luxury car, or to move to Lekki Phase 1 from Jota, believing that it has arrived. After brothers and sisters, to become the Ogorogobo, the first of Unewe, from the chief, is all kinds of titles, believing that the business has gotten to the level where they can relax. But you know the interesting thing? Any rise after the peak is a rise towards an inevitable downfall. Because of three things I mentioned all the time. Change in taste. Everybody say change in taste.
Change in taste.
Competition. Change in government policy. So we are advised that at the moment you are the peak, start creating the second goal from that point of strength. Because your peak period is your strength, your point of strength. If your business is thriving, you can go to the bank manager and ask for money for another business. Will he not give you? He will give it to you. As well, that first business can act as a collateral for the second. Have you? But if the business was in red, can you go to the bank and talk about the second shop? He said, okay, please help me. Let's clear this one first. True or false?
Yes, true.
And why do you have to take the second call? It's important to leverage the second business, just like I said, multiple competency. No business can survive forever in its original formation. So the second call may not be another business. It could just be a reinvention of that same business. So let's give a typical example. You have a shop where baking powder and flour is being sold at an Ade market. And you want to set the second call. What will be that second call? Anybody with an answer? You have a shop selling baking powder and flour, and you want to go into a second business. What should it be?
Right,
the bakery. The bakery is not recognized. That's the vertical move. You could do a horizontal one by setting up an hairdressing salon. Or say you want to sell auto cars. You may still make money, but you are bringing nothing from the first business into the second. And you may even lose your first business while struggling with the second, because that one is not the area of competence, have you? You have to rely on people, you have to pay for knowledge, isn't it?
Yes.
To make it work. But if you're taking a vertical growth, it means that you will move from baking powder shop to set up a bakery as a second company. Because what feeds the bakery is what is in your shop. And if the time the bakery has gotten to its own peak, when your sister used to help you has gone to set up her own in the next street, when your friend who can see that, yeah, you don't know where they make money from, has set up the third street, because that's what happens in Nigeria. Once you start a business, people around you will learn a little and become your competition. So, what should you do at the third call when the bakery is at its own peak? What's the third call? From shop of flour and baking powder to bakery, to what?
To
bakery, to a restaurant. Yes. Because the output of the bakery must be sold to two of us. That is if you want to go to .com. So the point is that in the 21st century, because of our need to have multiple streams of income and to do more than just one job, whatever we're doing as business today, we must begin to chart a path to the second call. Because very soon, that competitive advantage we have our first call will be eroded and challenged. And if that challenge is innovative enough, it will take. But before it's challenged, you take a step. It doesn't mean you have killed the first call. It's still there. As I've many times, I found that the absence of the second call confirmed the death of the first. Because industries have their boom and bust cycles. So it may be that the decline in sales of your first business will just be the question of the bust season and the boom will come in time. And if there is no second call to sustain the first business while it's waiting for the boom season of its own industry, when that boom comes, it will be dead. Am I coming across? So having a second call is not just about wanting to create more business, it's an insurance. Even against the demise of your core business. Because it will have its own system. If there is no other company that spends the salaries of those staff and is paying the rent of that business while the season is at its own post end, it dies naturally, isn't it? And when the boom comes, will it be allowed to take place? No. Nobody's going to say this, that business is gone. So it behoves every one of you in business. You are currently on your first call to ensure that by the time it's at peak, begin to think of the second call and make sure that it's a vertical growth rather than a horizontal growth. Because with the vertical growth, you are taking the same stuff might not be running into, isn't it? Because of the integration. I think I'm done. If you have questions, I'll take them. Thank you very much.